Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Today we begin the 18th topic of revisiting the history of the collection and transmission of the Quran. This 18th topic relates to an evaluation of the Isnad of the seven canonical readings. It is known that in the second or third century, a number of readings, variant readings, were in circulation in the Muslim Ummah. And out of these, Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, a very famous scholar of Quranic recitals and readings, selected seven readings and attributed each of them to some principal readers belonging to some main centers and territories of the Muslim Empire. And these seven readings then became very famous. If I just enumerate the people to whom these readings are ascribed, you can see that their names are being displayed. Nafi ibn Abdurrahman ibn Abi Nu'aym, he is a reciter of Medina. Then we have Abdullah ibn Kasir, a reciter of Mecca. Abu Bakr Asim ibn Abi Najud, a reciter of Kufa. He's the third person. Then in the fourth place, we have Abu Amara Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, also from Kufa, and Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisai, also from Kufa. So we have three people from Kufa, three people representing Kufa. In the sixth place, we have Abu Amr ibn Abul Ula al-Basri, who belongs to Basra. And in the seventh place, we have Abdullah ibn Amir al-Yahsubi, who belongs to Syria. So these were the seven famous reciters which were selected by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, and he attributed readings to them, which obviously we shall now discuss in these topics and these episodes vis-a-vis their isnad. It may also be kept in mind that before Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, other endeavors and other efforts were also made in order to select various readings from amongst the plethora of readings which were in circulation in the second and third centuries. Thus, we know that Ibn Jazri in his Nashr fil Qiraat al-Ashr has actually described this earlier history of this selection of by various people regarding these Quranic readings which were in vogue in those times. So before Ibn Mujahid, we have Abu Ubaid Qasim ibn Salam. He actually selected 25 readings. Then we have Abu Ahmed ibn Jubair al-Kufi. He selected five in his book on the Qiraat. Then we have Qazi Ismail ibn Ishaq al-Maliki. He compiled 20 of them. And then Abu Ja'far al-Tabri. All of these people are in chronological order. Abu Ja'far al-Tabri being the last of these. And he recorded over 20 readings. And then it was after them that Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid actually selected seven. And they became so famous that they were almost regarded to be the seven canonical readings. So therefore, it is now essential that we examine what these readings are, because the basic question that arises in this regard is that whatever the Quran is, we know that this is an ijma, a consensus of all our scholars and all our authorities, that it has to be mutawatir. The Quran cannot be something which is not mutawatir. So the question or the purpose of this inquiry is to investigate whether these readings also can be termed as mutawatir or not, because their isnad have been mentioned and cited in earlier books on Qiraat. So we have to examine these isnad to see whether they are mutawatir or not, because if they are not mutawatir, then obviously in accordance with the principle that anything which is not mutawatir cannot be the Quran, we cannot accept them per se in any way that they could be representing the Quran in any way. So this is the basic reason of our inquiry. And before we move on to study these isnad, I would like to enumerate some principles of my methodology which I have adopted in this regard. And since they are they present some basic premises in this regard, it is important that I briefly allude to these principles. Now, the methodological principles, I would say. So the first methodological principle which I would like to allude to is the fact that I have initially discussed only the upper isnad of these canonical readings. When I say upper isnad, I mean the narrator, the famous narrator, from him to a particular companion. So the chain which springs from a narrator to and goes right up to a companion of the Prophet, that is what I have termed as the upper isnad. So we will examine whether this part of the chain or transmission is mutawatir or not. And if it is not mutawatir, then we will not find any need to go in the lower isnad, which actually mean from that narrator to a compiler of a particular book in which these readings are mentioned. It's because if a reading is regarded to be a non-mutawatir in any section of its transmission, then it does not matter whether if other sections are mutawatir or not. Because once it becomes ahad or non-mutawatir in its particular section, then as in totality, it shall not be regarded as mutawatir. So we will first investigate the upper isnad. If the upper isnad gives us the impression that it is mutawatir, only then we'll go on to investigate the lower one. But as far as the upper isnad is concerned, it has to first get established that it is also mutawatir. So this is the methodology that I've adopted, that I'm going to investigate the first, the upper isnad as well. And only if the upper isnad comes out to be mutawatir, is there any need to go on to the lower isnad? Because as I said, that if the upper isnad is not non-mutawatir, then all these readings have to be consigned to the category of non-mutawatir, and hence they cannot be called mutawatir at all, and hence there is no need to even investigate the lower isnad. The second principle which I have adopted in this in this study is that the isnad narratives, which describe the teachers of these readers and their teachers as well, they contain certain Quranic readers who carry this information, who transmit this information, that who is the reader of who. And in this regard, they are basically acting as transmitters of information, of transmitters of hadith, if we use the word hadith in a very broad sense. So the jar on them has been entertained, because here they are not acting as merely Quran readers, they are acting as Quran transmitters. They are transmitting this information that such and such a person is the teacher of such and such a reader. So now the jar on them, which is found in Rijal books, shall be entertained, because the jar found in Rijal books actually pertains to a person who is transmitting something vis-a-vis regarding information, or if we broadly say regarding hadith. So although we accept the principle that the jar on the Quran readers as Quran readers shall not be accepted, but when these Quran readers, they are transmitting information, then we shall actually regard them to be people whose jar is mentioned in these books. And interestingly, what I have said here is corroborated by our works as well, because earlier works on Qiraat, like for example, Zahabi's Marifatul Qurra' al-Kibar and Al-Jazari's Ghayatul Nihaya, they actually give their verdict regarding the soundness or otherwise of a Quran transmitter. And when they regard him to be such, they're actually referring to his status as a transmitter of information or a transmitter of hadith. Because if we look up Rijal books for that particular narrator, for whom these books also present some jar or ta'dil, we'll find the same ta'dil or jar also found in Rijal books, which clearly shows that even people who are mentioning biographical accounts, people like Zahabi and Ibn al-Jazri, who are mentioning biographical accounts of these Quran readers, they are actually mentioning them not as merely as Quran readers, but also as transmitters of information, transmitters of hadith, as I said, in the broad sense. Therefore, in this case, as I said, whenever a reader is acting as a transmitter of information, then we shall entertain the jar which is found on that reader in Rijal books. The third point of importance and the third principle in this regard which I would adhere to is that wherever we do not find any tawseek or ta'deel regarding a Quran reciter acting as a narrator or a transmitter, then in this regard, a narrator or a transmitter, then in this regard we have to consign him to the category of majhool, because in the absence of any information, in the absence of any positive information about a person, we cannot know whether he is reliable or not, and hence he has to be consigned to the category of unreliability, and he'll be regarded as someone who is majhul or unknown, and hence in this regard also he would not be regarded as a worthy or a trustworthy transmitter or a narrator. The fourth point of principle, which actually is converse to the second one I just enumerated above, is that wherever a Quran reader is acting as a Quran reader and not as a hadith transmitter, then we will not entertain any jar on him, because all jar which is found in our Rijal books basically relates to people who are transmitting information. So a jar on a Quran reader per se has not been entertained in this regard. I would also like to point out that certain these Quranic readers which I've just enumerated above, which Ibn Mujahid has actually selected, We find even jar on them as Quran transmitters. Thus we have jar on Abdurrahman ibn Abi Nu'aym, who is actually Nafi ibn Abdurrahman ibn Nu'aym. We have jar on him, but because this jar relates to his capacity as a transmitter of information, we have not entertained that particular information because here he is under question as a Quran transmitter. Similar is the case of some other readers, like for example Asim ibn Bahdala or Asim ibn Abi Najud, who was also a Kufan reader, and he belongs to this category of seven canonical readers. Here we find, we have already discussed earlier in some of our earlier talks that Asim was inflicted by a bad memory, but then that memory related to his personality or his capacity of a hadith transmitter. Hence, that particular jar has not been entertained. Similar is the case with some of the other transmitters. So in a nutshell, I would say that wherever a Quran transmitter is mentioned as a Quran transmitter and not as a person who transmits information or hadith, that jar is not being entertained because that jar actually relates to his capacity of transmission, and that jar is not found on his capacity of a Quran transmitter himself. The fifth principle views which I have adhered to in this regard is that I have discussed only those teachers of these Quran transmitters and their own further teachers which are represented by some chain of narration which goes up to a companion. We do find some works presenting some names of Quran teachers of these famous readers, but they do not present any isnad. Thus, for example, we have authorities like Zahabi in his Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kabar and Ibn Jazri in his Ghayat al-Nihaya. They allude to Quran transmitters, but they do not mention any isnad. They just mention, for example, that such and such a person is also a teacher of such and such a narrator. But this information, although has been cited for academic interest, but it cannot be used to decipher whether they really exist or not, because in the absence of any chain of narration of a teacher, of a reader, we cannot rely on that particular information. Hence, only that information regarding a teacher has been entertained by me, which shows or exhibits unbroken isnad all the way up to a companion. So this is as far as the principles I'd like to enumerate before you is concerned, and I would say that on the basis of these five principles, I'll now conduct and present before you my research on the isnad of these seven famous reciters. And the sequence, viewers, that I'm going to adopt in this regard is that I'm going to discuss each of these seven narrators, the way Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid has cited them in sequence in his own book, his Kitab al-Sabah. We know that Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid's selection actually of these seven readers is mentioned and cited in his famous Kitab al-Sabah, and that is the same sequence shall be adopted by us and by me in this discussion and this evaluation. The first person or the first reader who has been mentioned by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, we shall now take up, and he is Nafi ibn Abdurrahman ibn Abi Nu'aym. He died in 169 Hijrah, and let me just give you a very brief recap on his biographical information. Bukhari mentions him as a Qari of Medina. Ibn Khayyat records on the authority of Al-Asma'i that he was originally from Asbahan. Azabi records on the authority of Al-Huzali that Nafi started teaching his reading to people in 95 Hijrah. So you can see the proximity of his period with the period of the earliest companions. His reading was taken to Africa by Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Khairun in the beginning of the 4th century. Ghazi ibn Qais studied his reading with him, and then he took his reading to Spain. And this has been mentioned by in Ad-Dibaj al-Muzhab fi Ma'rifat al-Ayan al-Muzhab. So we know that he had students who studied with him, as was the case previously. We saw Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Khairun, and he was the person who actually took his reading to North Africa or to the northern part of Africa. And this has been mentioned by Zahabi in his Tariq al-Islam. But as far as Ghazi ibn Qais's information is concerned, this has been mentioned by Ibrahim ibn Ali ibn Muhammad ibn Farhun al-Maliki in his Ad-Dibaj. Another thing which needs to be also gauged is the fact that Imam Malik is reported to have learnt the Quran from him by reading it out to him. The words are, أَخَذَلْ قِرَاءَ عَرْضًا عَنْ نَافِ. So he actually learnt the Qiraat of Nafi by presenting it before Nafi. And as such, Imam Malik regards himself to be a student of Imam Nafi in the matters of recitals and reading the Quran. And this has been famously alluded to by Ibn Khalikan in his Al-Wafiyat al-Ayan. Viewers, now with this broad introduction or very brief introduction regarding Nafi's background and his information, I'm now going to take up the his teachers which are mentioned. And before I actually do so, I would also like to present some broad information which has been cited by various Qiraat books. Now, Nafi has said that he learned the Quran from 70 Tabi'un. He says that he does not name them, he just says that he learned the Quran from 70 Tabi'un. And this particular narrative, viewers, has been cited by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid in his Kitab al-Sarba. And as you can see, that its text is being displayed before you. The words are, قال أبو بكر فقلت له الزبيدي فقال الزبيدي قال حدثنا أبو قرة. So actually the basic person who is reporting this from Nafi is Abu Qurra. And Abu Qurra says, أبو سمعت نافيا يقول قرأت على سبعين من التابعين. Abu Qurra heard Nafi saying that I read out the Quran to 70 Tabi'un. And we know Tabi'un are the people who are actually the next generation to the Sahaba or the companions, also called followers or successors. So this is how this has been presented. Besides Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid, we find Adani also mentioning or alluding to this particular report of Nafi, telling us that he had actually 70 teachers, or he learned the Quran from 70 Tabi'un. Now, I would like to also examine this report in the light of historical criticism. The first critique that comes to my mind regarding this report is that out of Nafi's many students, only a Yemenite student who is Abu Qurra, and Abu Qurra is actually Musa ibn Tariq. Abu Qurra is the kunya of Musa ibn Tariq. He reports this narrative from Mizzi, from him. Hafiz Mizzi has actually enlisted over 20 of his students. So Nafi had over 20 students, and we just find a single student, and he too is a Yemenite, Abu Qurra, Musa ibn Tariq, narrating it to him. So this is something of an alarm that rings in my mind, that how come that this information was just transmitted by just one of his students. Furthermore, viewers, this narrative in itself is also suspect. Though authorities generally regard Abu Qurra to be reliable, Abu Qurra, who is the person who is actually reporting this narrative from Nafi, although authorities regard him to be reliable, some of the jar that is recorded on him is that Abu Hatim's opinion about him is this, yuktabu hadithuhu wa la yuhtajju bihi. Ibn Hajar records the comment about him that he is sika yughribu. Similarly, another person who figures in the chain of narration of this narrative, and you can see that this chain of narration is being displayed before you and indicated by an arrow, the person of Abu Huma Muhammad ibn Yusuf. Now, Ibn Hibban records, Rubbama akhta wa aghraba. This is about Abu Huma Muhammad ibn Yusuf. Ibn Hajar records the following words of Ibn al-Qattan about him. I am not aware of him. So, la arifu halahu is actually what he has said. And when Ibn al-Qattan says these words, then it really means that he is a person who is very, very little known, or maybe unknown, because if he is a person who is saying that he does not know who this person is, then we can get some idea of the fact that he is not a very well-known person. So viewers, on the basis of these points, I would not regard this narrative to be of much worth, because even if Nafi is ascribed this statement, I would say that this statement ascribed to Nafi has not been reliably reported in history. And hence, I would confine myself to those teachers of Nafi who have actually been mentioned. And let me first just point out his teachers who have been mentioned through various isnad, and then I'll also mention some of his teachers which are mentioned by some of the other authorities, but they do not mention any isnad. They do not mention any chain of narration for those teachers. As far as those teachers are concerned, viewers, who do have an isnad, mentioned by regarding their own ascription as being teachers of Nafi. We have Salih ibn Khawwat. Then we have Muslim ibn Jundub al-Huzali. Then we have Abdul Rahman ibn Hurmuz al-A'raj. In the fourth place, we have Abu Ja'far Yazid ibn al-Qa'qa. He is the Mawla of Abdullah ibn Ayyash ibn Abi Rabi'a, and actually Abdul Rahman ibn Hurmuz, who I mentioned in the third place, is the Mawla of Muhammad ibn Rabi'a ibn Haris ibn Abdul Muttalib. The fifth person, viewers, the fifth teacher of Imam Nafi is Abu Ruh Yazid ibn Ruman, and he is the Mawla of Az-Zubair ibn al-Awwam. And in the sixth place, we have Abu Maimuna Shaiba ibn Nisah ibn Sarjis, and he's the Mawla of Salama. And in the seventh place, we have Abdul Rahman ibn Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. So these are the seven teachers of Imam Nafi who have been reported by a chain of narration or an Isnad. Because now we take up the names of those teachers which have been reported without any chain of narration, have been cited by authorities without any Isnad. The first of them is Asbakh ibn Abdul Aziz al-Nahawi. The second is Abu Zannad Abu Abdullah ibn Zakwan Mawla Ramla bint Shaiba. And the third is Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Shahab al-Zuhri, the famous Tabi'i. So all these three teachers of Imam Nafi are mentioned by Abu Abdullah Ali ibn Ahmad ibn Abdullah Sibt al-Khayyat. And he has mentioned them in his book Al-Mubhij fil Qira'at al-Sab'. So all these three teachers, they are mentioned by him only. And we do not find their mention in some of the other major works. So just for the purpose of academic aspect or academic interest, I have cited their names. But as I said, we will not deal with them in detail or in any other description to as the teachers of Imam Nafi because of the fact that they do not carry any chain of narration. Now, let us take up the teachers of Imam Nafi one by one. And here I refer to those teachers who have been reported by an isnad or a chain of narration. The first person viewers in this regard is Salih ibn Khawwat. Now, with the exception of Ibn al-Jazari, almost no authority regards him to be even a Qari. So except for Ibn al-Jazari, there's no authority who even says that he's a Qari. And we know when a person is a Qari, he is a person who is actually a Quran reciter or a Quran reader or even a Quran memorizer. So Ibn Sa'd al-Bukhari and Ibn Abi Hatim, Ibn Habban, al-Baji, Ibn Makula, Ibn Asir, al-Mizzi, Mughaltai, al-Safadi, Ibn Hajar, al-Suyuti, do not mention him. And all these people are historians, viewers. These are people who have their own books. Thus, for example, Ibn Sa'd in his At-Tabaqat al-Kubra, Bukhari in his Tariq al-Kabir, Ibn Abi Hatim in his Al-Jarh wa-Ta'dil, Ibn Habban in his Al-Siqat, Al-Baji in his Al-Ta'dil wa-Tajri, Ibn Makula in his Al-Ikmal fi Raf'ir al-Irti'ab, and similarly, Ibn al-Jazari or Ibn Asir al-Jazari, he's in his Jami' al-Rasul fi Ahadith al-Rasul, and Al-Mizzi in his Tehzib al-Kamal. Similarly, Mughaltai in his Ikmal Ikmal Tehzib al-Kamal fi Asma' al-Rijal, and some of the other persons, like for example, Safadi in his Wafayat, Al-Wafi bil-Wafayat, and Ibn Hajar in his Tehzib al-Tehzib, and As-Suyuti in his Is'af al-Mubta. So, these are the people, viewers, who have actually cited information regarding Salih ibn Khawwat. These are all people who have cited biographical accounts of Salih ibn Khawwat, but we do not mention any of these authorities mentioning Salih ibn Khawwat in the capacity of a Quran reader. Ibn Sa'd actually goes on to further say that he is Qalilul Hadith. Now, Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid and Ad-Dani record Salih ibn Khawwat to be a teacher of Nafi. So, two of the earlier authorities, although the people I have just mentioned, historians and biographers, they do not mention him as a Qari, but let us now take up Ibn Mujahid and Ad-Dani. Both of them mention him to be a teacher of Nafi, but it is quite strange that Zahabi does not even mention him as an independent entry in his encyclopedic work on this subject. And when I refer to this, I actually refer to his famous book, Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. So, So what has happened here is that Saleh ibn Khawwat is not even mentioned in Zahabi's Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar as an independent entry. We know that Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar of Zahabi presents scores of reciters who belong to the various tabaqa of various generations, in fact. And they are all named separately. But Saleh ibn Khawwat is not named as a separate. He may be mentioned in texts regarding some other narrator, but as an independent entry, having his own name, he's not even mentioned thus. Ibn Jazari mentions Nafi to have recited out to Saleh ibn Khawwat, and that Saleh acquired his Quranic reading from Abu Huraira. So that's the further information that we get from Ghayatul Nihaya, another very famous and a very primary work on the biographical accounts of the Qurra. So Ibn al-Jazri is in Ghayatul Nihaya says that Nafi did read out the Quran, recited the Quran to Saleh ibn Khawwat, and that Saleh himself acquired the Quran from Abu Huraira. So now I'm going to read out a narrative which has actually Ibn Mujahid has recorded. And he says, قَالَسْ سَمِعْتُ أَبَا الْقَاسِمَ وَاسًا يَخُولُ أَخْبَرَنِي يُوسُفُ بْنِ عَمَرُ أَنَّ نَافِيًا قَرَى عَلَى صَالِحِ بْنِ خَوَّاتِ أَخْبَرُهُ بِذَلِكَ عَبْدُ الْمَلِكِ بْنُ مَسْلِمَ. So Abu al-Qasim al-Wasan says that Yusuf ibn Amr informed him that Nafi read out the Quran to Saleh ibn Khawwat. So this is an isnad-based ascription of Nafi to his teacher, Saleh ibn Khawwat. And Yusuf was informed of this by Abdul Malik ibn Muslimah. That's the last part of this narrative. Now, as you can see, that is chain of narration is being displayed before you. The jar on Abdul Malik ibn Maslamah, who is the informant of Yusuf, as recorded by Az-Zahabi in his Mizan al-Itizal, is that Ibn Yunus regards him to be Munkarul Hadith. Ibn Hibban says that he narrates a lot of manaqib from the people of Medina. Ibn Abi Hatim, and Ibn Abi Hatim is Al-Jarh wa Ta'dil, records the opinion of Abu Hatim, or his father, about him as Katabtu anhu wa huwa muzdaribul hadith laysa biqawi. So that is what he says, that although he has written from him, but he has discrepancies in his reports, and he does not have a sound memory. He also records, and Ibn Abi Hatim also records the opinion of Abu Zur'a about him as laysa bilqawi huwa munkarul hadith. So that's another important information that Abu Zura has added in this regard. Moreover, who or what is the source of Abdul Malik ibn Maslama is not known. So when even the source of Muhammad ibn Malik ibn Maslama is not known, therefore we can clearly see the issue of an inqita here. This question actually arises because Yusuf ibn Amr ibn Yasar al-Azraq is actually a student of Nafi, Nafi's student Warsh. So you can see clearly the presence of this inqita. Now, viewers, furthermore, no information is available on Al-Husayn ibn Ali as-Sadafi, as you can see that his name is also being displayed. It can thus be concluded that Saleh ibn Khawwat cannot be reliably regarded to be a teacher of Imam Nafi. And we have also no isnad-based content which tells us who the teacher of Saleh ibn Khawwat was. Because obviously Saleh ibn Khawwat would have been a person who had acquired reading of the Quran from some other authority who was his superior or his senior. So we have no isnad-based content. The only isnad-based content we have regarding Saleh ibn Khawwat himself being the teacher of Nafi, and that too is not reliable. However, as far as Saleh is concerned, we do not know who his teachers are and who the teachers of his teacher are. So therefore, this is another problem that we have to face. And in all totality and in all honesty, we can clearly see the nature of unreliability of the fact whether Saleh is the teacher of Nafi or not. And then, who is the teacher of Saleh himself? We do not have any. It's not just have a report saying that Abu Huraira was his teacher, but there is no isnad involved in this. We move on to the second teacher of Imam Nafi, and he is Muslim ibn Jundab al-Huzali. So sources describe him to be a qazi and a sermonizer of Medina. And when I say these sources, I, for example, refer to Imam Bukhari's Tarikh al-Kabir and Ibn Hibban's As-Siqat. So they describe him to be a qazi and a sermonizer of Medina. Now, in the following narratives, he is mentioned as a teacher of Imam Nafi. Now, I'm going to just cite these narratives. The first of these narratives, viewers, is cited by Abu Zura al-Dimashqi in his Tarikh, the famous Tarikh of Abu Zura. So you can see that its text is being cited before you. It says, Haddasana Ishaq al-Masisi, Haddasana Ishaq al-Musayyibi, Annahu Samia Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym Yaqul, Akhastu al-Qira' an Abi Jafar al-Qari wa Abdir Rahman al-Araj wa Shayba bin. The words actually are Nusalli, and we can clearly see that this has to be a Tashif. It has to be Shayba ibn Nasah wa Muslim ibn Jundab. So these are the people who Nafi himself names as his teacher. He says that, actually, it says that Ishaq al-Musayyibi heard Nafi say, I acquired my reading from Abu Jafar Yazid ibn Qarqa al-Qari, that's his full name, Abdul Rahman al-Araj, and Shayba al-Nusalli, which, as I said, is actually Shayba al-Nasa. And the last person that he names is Muslim ibn Jundab, and that is the person, viewers, that we are just going to discuss. So as far as this particular isnad is concerned, viewers, it is perfectly okay, and therefore we do not have any problem with it. The second of these, viewers, now I'm going to cite, and this has been actually reported by Ad-Dani in his Jami'ul Bayan fil Qira'at al-Sab'a al-Mashhura, and this particular report, viewers, I'm going to cite, is, it says that an Ishaq al-Nafi qal, وَسَّمِعْتُ نَافِيًا يَكُولُ أَدْرَكْتُ أَيْمَّا بِالْمَدِينَةِ يُقْتَدَى بِهِمْ مِنْهُمْ عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنُ بْنُ هُرْمُزْ الْعَارَجُ وَيَزِيدُ بْنُ رُمَانُ وَشَيْبَةُ بْنُ نَصَاهُ وَأَبُو جَعْفَرُ بْنُ يَزِيدُ بْنُ الْقَعْقَى وَمُسْلِمُ بْنُ جُنْدَبْ وَأُنَاسًا لَمْ يَكْتُبْهُمْ إِسْحَاقُ قَالَ نَافِعٌ فَنَظَرْتُ إِلَى مَجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ اثْنَانِ مِنْهُمْ أَخَذْتُ بِهِ وَمَا شَذَّ فِيهِ وَاحِدًا تَرَكْتُهُ حَتَّى أَلَّفْتُ هَذِهِ الْقِرَاءَةَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحُرُوفِ الَّتِي اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَيْهَا. So Ishaq ibn Muhammad said that he heard Nafi say, I found in Medina religious leaders who were followed by the masses. Among them were, now he is naming those people. Among them were Abdul Rahman ibn Hurmuz al-Araj, Yazid ibn Ruman, Shayba ibn Nisah, Abu Jafar Yazid ibn al-Qarqa, Muslim ibn Jundab. And the narrator added that there were other people as well among them whom Ishaq, and he did not name. So he actually just named the people who have been actually cited here, but there are some of the others that he did not name. Or he did not write down, actually. So Nafi said, and he continues what he says, he says that I observed what at least two of them agreed upon and acquired it and left out all that which only one of them was the source until I synthesized this reading in these words on which people are now gathered. So Nafi has just plainly said that he met various people, and any reading on which two people were agreed upon, he would take up that reading, he would take up that particular qiraat, and he would leave out qiraat which was just being read by a single person. And this is, he says that I synthesize this qiraat. I actually, the words are, hatta allaftu hazil qiraat. This is how actually I synthesized my reading, by taking readings from various people on which two people agreed. And if any one person was the person who was representing a reading, he would not take that. So any reading which was in which two people were unanimous, he would just take up that reading, and he then synthesized the whole readings of the Quran simply by gathering what his two teachers had said. And I say teachers, then of course I mean people on whom people who were two in number. Now, viewers, the isnad of this narrative is also reportedly fine. It's okay. We cannot find any problems in it. I have analyzed it and evaluated it. I think that it is reliably reported. In this regard, viewers, the third narrative I'm now going to cite, and this is also cited by Dani in his Jami' fil Qira'at al-Sab'a al-Bayan al-Mashura. This narrative, viewers, is now I'm what I'm going, this text is, I'm not going to read out now before you. So it says, حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن داود بن أبي ثيبة قال قرأت على أبي وأخبرني أنه قرأ على ورش وأخبرني أنه قرأ على نافع قال وأخبرني أنه قرأ على خمسة وأخبرني الخمسة and خمسة of course here have not been named, the five have not been named. وأخبرني خمسة أنه أنهم قرأوا على عبد الله بن عياش بن أبي ربيعة وأخبرهم عبد الله بن عياش بن أبي ربيعة أنه قرأ على عبي بن كعب وأخبرني أنه قرأ على رسول الله قال وقرأ النبي عليه. Verse said, Nafi informed me that he read out the Quran to five. Nafi said, the five informed me that they read out to Abdullah ibn Ayyash ibn Abi Rabiya and Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Ayyash ibn Abi Rabiya informed them that he read out to Ubay. Abdullah ibn Ayyash ibn Rabiya said, Ubay informed me that he read out to the Messenger of God, and then it is said, wa qara an-nabi alayya, that the Prophet also read out to me. Now, viewers, this narrative is ambiguous in the sense that it does not mention the names of the five teachers of Nafi. It does not even mention them. As you can see, I already pointed this out while I was reading the narrative. It says, "Wa akhbarani al-khamsa annahum qara'u ala Abdullah ibn Ayyash." Who are these khamsa? Who are these five people? They are not named. So, besides this problem, I would also like to point out some of the other issues in this narrative. First of all, viewers, no tawseek is available on Umar ibn Muhammad ibn Iraq and Muhammad ibn al-Hasan ibn Umar, as you can see that their names are being displayed and indicated by an arrow. Abu al-Qusam Abdul Rahman ibn Dawud ibn Abi Taiba and Dawud ibn Abi Taiba. So these are the people on which we do not have any tawseek. According to Ibn al-Jazari, while a group regards Abu Muhammad al-Hasan ibn Rushaik, again this being indicated before you, to be reliable. Al-Hafiz Abdul Ghani ibn Sayyid regards him to be on the weaker side. So, although he is a person who is regarded to be reliable by as one authority, another authority says that he is on the weaker side and actually his words are layyanahu. So it is evident from the above details that we cannot rely on this narrative. We cannot rely, although the first two narratives I cited, they are reliable, but this third narrative, because of this information, is not reliable. Let me now move on to the fourth narrative, viewers, which is recited in this regard. And the fourth narrative actually has five different tahweels. It has five different sections in which it has been reported. In this regard, viewers, I'm just going to first read out the narrative before you. This narrative has been reported by Ad-Dani in his Jami al-Bayan fil Qirat al-Sab'a al-Mashhura. It says, حَدَّثَنَا أَحْمَدُ بْنُ مُحَمَّدُ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا أَحْمَدُ بْنُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا بَكْرُ بْنُ سَهَلُ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا عَبْدُ الصَّمَدُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ. And then we have a tahweel. حَدَّثَنَا فَارِسُ بْنُ أَحْمَدُ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ الْحَسَنِ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا إِبْنُ عَبْدِ الرَّزَّاقِ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا بَكْرُ بْنُ سَهَلُ وَعَبْدُ الْجَبَّارِ بْنُ مُحَمَّدُ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا عَبْدُ الصَّمَدُ. Now we still have another tahweel. وحدثنا محمد بن سعيد الإمام في كتابه قال حدثنا محمد بن أحمد بن خالد قال حدثنا أبي قال حدثنا إبراهيم بن محمد قال حدثنا عبد الصمد. And then we have another تهويل. حدثنا طاهر بن غلبون قال حدثنا إبراهيم بن محمد قال حدثنا أبو بكر بن السيف قال يوسف. And we have still another tahweel. It says, وحدثنا فارس بن أحمد قال حدثنا عمر بن محمد الإمام قال حدثنا أحمد بن زكريا قال حدثنا عبيد بن محمد قال حدثنا داود بن أبي ثيبة قالوا. Now these are the people who are now reporting it in a unanimous way. قالوا حدثنا عثمان بن سعيد ورش النافع ورجال النافع عبد الرحمن بن العارج وأبو جعفر القاري وشيبة بن النساء ومسلم بن جندب ويزيد بن رومان وعبد الرحمن بن القاسم وهو عبد الرحمن بن القاسم بن محمد بن أبي بكر الصديق وقد تعبه على ذكره في رجال النافع أحمد بن جبير عن إسحاق المسيبي. So viewers, I'm just going to summarize The translation, I'm not going to read out the isnad in the translation because you can see the isnad once I read out this translation being displayed before you in the form of a chart. So, Warsh reported from Nafi
and the Rijal.
Rijal here, of course, refers to the teachers of Nafi. They are Abdul Rahman ibn Arij, Abu Jafar al-Qari, Shayba ibn Nisah, Muslim ibn Jundab, Yazid ibn Roman, and Abdul Rahman ibn Qasim, who is actually Abdul Rahman ibn Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr al-Siddiq. Warsh also mentioned Abdul Rahman ibn Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr al-Siddiq
among the teachers
of Nafi in another chain of narration, in which Ahmed ibn Jubair reports from Ishaq al-Musayyibi. So this is information which we need to first just stick in our minds, and I'm now going to analyze this whole narrative before you, and you can see that it is being displayed before you in the form of a chart. And this schematic illustration of this chart, viewers, you can see that it has five sections, and I'm afraid this narrative is weak in all its five sections, and I'm now just going to take them up one by one. So in the first section, viewers, no tawseek is available on Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Ibrahim ibn Muhammad, and hence I would regard him to be majhul. Now it may be noted that Az-Zahabi and Ibn al-Jazari mention him. Bikr ibn Sahal is zaif in the opinion of An-Nasai. So you can see that Bikr ibn Sahal, who has been, actually there is a difference here. He's either Bakr ibn Sahal, and some other sources say it's Bikr ibn Sahal. But whoever he is, whether Bikr or Bakr, he is a person who in the opinion of An-Nasai is zaif. So this is as far as the first section is concerned, which is the leftmost section. In the second section, viewers, no tawseek is available on Abdul Jabbar or Muhammad al-Muallim. Hence, he is majhul. Again, it is the same barometer that I have adopted. It may be noted that Ibn al-Jazari does mention him. I have not been able to find any other biographical source that mentions his biographical details. So the only person who mentions him is Ibn al-Jazari in his Ghayatul Nihaya fi Tabaqat al-Qurra. Similarly, viewers, no tawseek is available on Abu Tahir Muhammad ibn Hassan ibn Ali ibn Tahir. Now, he is a person, you can see, he is being displayed, he has been indicated in the second section. So, therefore, viewers, I will tend to regard him to be majhul as well. It may be noted that Ibn al-Jazari and As-Suyuti mention him, but I have not been able to find any biographical information about him in any other source. So we can clearly see that although accounts mention him and they also mention his some of his details, but they do not mention any tawseek. They do not mention any tawseek on him, and hence we cannot regard him to be a person of this category. Now, viewers, we come to the third section. You can see that the third section is also being displayed before you. In the third section, no tawseek is available on Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Khalid. Now you can see that his name is being indicated. So therefore, I would regard him to be majhul. He is also majhulul ayn, viewers, because only one person, and he is Abu Muhammad, Maslama ibn Muhammad, who narrates from him. So he's also totality that he's also majhulul ayn. Now the only source to mention him is Jawza al-Muqmis fi Zikr al-Vulat al-Undulus, and this is a book by al-Humaydi. So he is actually Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Futu ibn Humayd al-Humaydi. So he is only mentioned there, but we do not have any tawseek on him. So neither al-Zahabi nor Ibn al-Jazari mention him. They do not even mention him. Also, no person by the name of Muhammad ibn Sa'id, who is a Danis Sheikh, can be identified. And as you can see, viewers, in this chain of narration, in the third section, we find that Muhammad ibn Sa'id is a Dani's teacher. But this is what the narrative says, but no Rijal work actually confirms this. So this is a further problem. Viewers, in the fourth chain of narration, you can see, which is being displayed before you, the fourth section actually, not the chain of narration, the fourth section, Ibrahim ibn Muhammad ibn Marwan, according to Imam Dar Qutni, he says, Ghamazuhu, which means that authorities have impugned him, and this has been mentioned, viewers, in Ibn Hajar's Lisan al-Mizan. In the fifth, now we move on to the fifth section, viewers. In the fifth section, no Tawseeq is available on Abu Hafs Umar ibn Muhammad ibn Iraq. And therefore, as I said, in accordance with my own principles, he would be majhul. It may be noted that Az-Zahabi ibn al-Jazari and Suyuti have mentioned him, but no Tawseeq is available on him. Similarly, viewers, there is no Tawseeq available on Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Yahya ibn Zakariya. His name is also being indicated, but there is no Tawseeq available on him. Hence, he is also majhul. It may also be noted that Ibn Jazari mentions him in his Ghayatul Nihaya, but of course, when he mentions him, he does not give any further information. Moreover, viewers, no Tawseeq is available on Ubayd ibn Muhammad ibn Musa. He also figures in the chain of narration as being indicated before you. Hence, he also is majhul. I would just concede the fact that Ibn Jazari just mentioned him, but he does not mention any Tawseeq, neither does any other authority. Furthermore, viewers, no Tawseeq is available on Dawud ibn Abi Taiba, and therefore he too is majhurul hal. And it may be noted that Az-Zahabi and Ibn Jazari mention him, but of course they do not mention any Tawseeq on him. So in short, all the narrators in this subchain are majhurul hal. So viewers, if I sum up this information regarding the four narratives which I just cited, we can clearly see that amongst these four narratives, only one and two are reliably reported, three and four are not. And so therefore, we can clearly see that we do not have any sound information about the teachers of Muslim Ibn Jundub because they are not cited. The only narrative to cite a teacher of Muslim Ibn Jundub is narrative number three. But unfortunately, that narrative is unreliable. So viewers, I will end my talk here on this particular episode. This discussion is now going to continue in the next episode, in which we will discuss Muslim ibn Jundub's teachers, which have not been reported by Isnad. And then also we shall take up some of all the rest of the teachers of Imam Nafi himself. Remember, we are discussing the teachers of Imam Nafi. So we've discussed, and we are now discussing his second teacher, is Muslim ibn Jundub. And Muslim ibn Jundub's also account has not complete as yet. We'll complete it in the next episode. In this episode, we have discussed his teachers, which are supported through Isnad. But in the next, we shall discuss some of his other teachers. And then, viewers, we'll go on to discuss the remaining teachers of Imam Nafi himself before we take up the other narrators. So until then, أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات.